Good morning. Would you stand and sing with us? Joy to the world. Baptist Weddings, and we're glad that you're here. Would you go ahead and be seated? So if the first song wasn't an indication of the direction of our service, if you've gone ahead in your reading to see where we're going today, we're talking about joy. And so spending this week meditating on joy, thinking about joy, I was reminded of a quote of C.S. Lewis, actually. And it surprisingly comes out of his Reflections on his wife passing. But he says this, that praise is the mode of love which always has some element of joy in it. And so as we sing, and we sing expectantly about Christmas and what is coming, about Jesus coming, about what Jesus has done, I'd ask us to reflect on that. That what does it actually mean to have joy? Joy that's different than happiness, joy that's different than gladness. But that what our praise will be joyful because of the way that we've been loved. Would you stand and sing with us?
This is Pastor Sam Roach. Thank you for joining us via live stream for our morning worship service at First Baptist Church of Weddington. We are located at 348 Providence Road South in Weddington, North Carolina. We fulfill the great commission of making disciples by loving God and others, growing in fellowship, study, and prayer, serving joyfully, and going out to share the gospel. Well, I'm glad you have joined us via live stream. If you live in the Charlotte area, I want to invite you to join us in person this coming Sunday. We have small groups, what we call Bible fellowship classes, for all ages that meet at 9:30 a.m., followed by our morning worship service at 11 a.m. So if you live here in Charlotte, I hope you will join us here at First Baptist Weddington this coming Sunday. If you live in another area, I want to encourage you to please find a Bible teaching church that you can attend in person. If you're not physically able to attend church in person, my hope and prayer is that this live stream ministry will bless you and glorify God in your life.
Expectation of what we hope will be. It's described as being lost in the woods and coming across a signpost that points you back to the path. That you feel in that moment a moment of joy. But it's not joy for finding something in the woods. It's joy for what it's directing you to. And the call is that when we want more joy in our life, that really what we want is more Jesus. And so this next song that may be new for some talks about that expectation of Jesus coming, but also recognizing that Jesus didn't come just to come as a person and that be it. So would you sing, "Come Behold the Wondrous Mystery" with us?
Praises, brought in frail and new. Christ alone on the tree, in the stead of the receivers, is the Lamb in victory. See the price of our redemption, see the Lord is put on for, bringing many sons to
in your bulletins, you have a little blue insert. If you could fill that out and put that in the offering tray as we pass that around. And please pray with me. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you for who you are and everything that you give us. You just give us so much. We're not hungry. We're fed. We're clothed. You give us shelter. You give us so much. But most of all, you gave us your Son. And this is a season we celebrate his birth. And we just thank you for all the many blessings that you give us each and every day that we often take for granted. And thank you for the opportunity to give a small portion of what is yours back to you for the furtherment of your kingdom. We pray all of this in your precious name. Amen.
Last week we heard about love, so we have lyrics. If you're so led, we would invite you to sing with us. He is jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath weight of his wind and mercy. All of a sudden, I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory. And I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. Oh, how he loves us so. Sing that again. He is jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, I realize. realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. Oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so. Sing, yeah, he loves. Yeah, he loves us. Whoa, how he loves us. Whoa, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves. Yeah, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves.
Thank you so much, Praise Ben. What would we do if we couldn't wake up every morning and profess and confess that he loves us? What would life be like if we didn't have that eternal hope that we have, knowing that he loves us? The evidence in his word is just overwhelming of his love for us. And of course, it culminates on the cross of Calvary in the empty tomb. We are forever grateful for his love. Well, good morning. Hope you all are well this morning. Glad you all made it out to worship us this morning. Please turn in your Bibles, if you will, to Isaiah chapter 35. Isaiah chapter 35. We are entering into our third week of this Advent season. It is flying by. I don't know if any of you feel like that. Every year I'm like, you know what, I'm going to slow down and I'm going to enjoy it more because it went by so fast last time. And then you wake up this morning and you see it's already the 15th. Christmas is in 10 days. And I'm like, okay, you know what, we're going to slow down now, right? So part of my prayer this morning is that we can all slow down just a little bit to savor it and enjoy and reflect upon what God has given us in Jesus Christ the remainder of this Advent season. So the first week of Advent, we focused on what? Anyone remember? Hope. Very good. Very good. A plus. Okay. We focused on hope. Last Sunday, Chuck just stole my thunder and gave it away. We looked at love, right? We looked at love last week. Well, today we look at joy. We look at joy, and it is not just any joy, but it is an everlasting joy. It's a joy that only comes from the Lord. And because this love only comes from the Lord, it is a joy that the world will never know. It is a joy that they cannot understand, but unfortunately, it is a joy that seems elusive to most Christians today. It's a joy that we seem to overlook. It's a joy that we don't seem to embrace as we should as Christians. And what I mean by this is that we know of God's creation and man's fall. We know the word. We know that God has redeemed us through the blood of Jesus. We know that Christ has conquered death and is alive forevermore. We know that we have been given the Holy Spirit of the living God to be with us and empower us throughout life. We know that we one day will be with him forever in a restored creation. And this is a promise, one of many promises that God has given us in his word. But even though we know these things, even though we're told these things, we read these things in his word and we hear about them in Sunday school and in devotions that we do, too many Christians do not apply the truths of God's word to our hearts and our lives in a real and personal way, in a way that is life-changing. We don't see that enough in our lives. We let the world define our reality rather than let the Word of God give us joy. We let the world define who we are and what our value is. But you see, there is joy. There is joy that comes from knowing, believing, and applying God's Word, His promises. There is a joy that comes from that that this world cannot give us. Now, as humans, it is our tendency to try to find this joy in any way possible other than the Lord, other than His Word and His promises. We try to find it in our relationships, the amount of money in our retirement accounts. We try to find joy in our career. We try to find joy in our titles, whatever they may be. Now understand that there is a degree of joy and a degree of happiness that comes from these. But in these, we are defining ourselves in ways that are not God's ways. Thus, we feel unfulfilled in our efforts. We feel unfulfilled, and the glowing ember of joy and happiness that we have garnered from these things will slowly fade. And the heat produced from this little ember will not sustain us. We will not be satisfied. And instead of looking to the everlasting joy that comes from a relationship with Jesus Christ, instead we will be looking for the next temporary joy. You see, that's what we get on so many times as Christians. We are built for joy. We are built for happiness. We are built to be fulfilled by God. But too many times, we just hop on the merry-go-round of this world with its ups and downs and rounds, and we never get anywhere. We get off, and then we get down because that joy didn't last. And instead of looking for something fulfilling, we get right back in line and get back on the same ride again, expecting something else. We look for that very next temporary joy. Well, in today's verse, we will look at where our joy is, where true joy comes from, what our identity is, what we can gain from this everlasting joy that God has for us, and also what we mercifully lose as a result of having this everlasting joy. So if you haven't already, turn in your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 35, we will be looking at verse 10. And please stand as you are able in honor of the reading of God's word as we read Isaiah chapter 35, verse 10. And Isaiah wrote, "And the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy will be upon their heads, and they shall obtain gladness and joy, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away." Let us pray. Father God, we thank you so much for the precious, enduring, never-ending gift of your word, Father. Father, I pray that you will give us an appetite for your word that will never be satisfied, but will always leave us fulfilled, but always wanting more of it. Always wanting more of you. Father, I pray for the congregation's hearts this morning, Lord, that you will just open them up through your Holy Spirit to receive your word, Lord, to be able to understand it and apply it to their lives in a way that can only come through your precious Holy Spirit. And Father, I pray for myself this morning, Lord, that you will just minimize me and increase yourself, Father. Lord, we love you, and all these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. So Isaiah 35 comes on the heels of judgment pronounced against Edom in chapter 34. And like we see oftentimes in Scripture, this provides a stark contrast of sin and God's judgment followed up by God's restoration and hope and joy that come from that. So while in captivity in Babylon, the people of Judah were given hope. They were given hope. We can't understand the hopelessness that they felt as they were taken over into captivity. They were yearning for hope, and God gave it to them. They were given these encouraging words of prophecy by the Lord through Isaiah. All of the entire chapter culminates, reaches its peak in verse 10, our key verse this morning. So let's break down this verse and look at the treasures that are contained within it. Beginning here, it says, the ransomed of the Lord. The ransomed of the Lord. Isaiah tells them that they will be ransomed by God. Now, when ransom is used in conjunction with and paralleled with being redeemed, as you see back in verse 9, it talks about being redeemed. It involves an exchange to buy something back. Something that was previously owned and is still remaining in your possession, but you no longer have access to. And that is what it says here. It says, they are the ransomed of God. They are the ransomed of the Lord. In other words, even though they were in exile because of their sin, God had not forsaken them. God had not forgotten them. They are still His through all of this. Think about how we can apply that to our lives. Everyone in here has sinned. We have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We all know this. Shallow sins, deep sins, cannonballs into the deep end. We've all done it. But in spite of all of those things, God loves us. You are still His. As a Christian, we sin. John says if we say we don't sin, the love of God's not in us. We're denying it. We're denying Him. We're making God a liar. As Christians, we struggle all the more against sin because when you're not saved, you don't care. But here, God is giving the example to them, and I believe what we can get as well, that even though we sin, we are still His. We see this in the story of the prodigal son, where even though the son went astray, it was still his son. Can any of you ever stop being a child of your father? The answer is no, you can't. And it's the same. Once you are a child of God, you will always be His. He will always be your father. So their identity, the people's identity, even in exile, is that they are His. They are His. His promises are true. His love unmerited. That even in their darkest time, a time that, guys, it's not a time that they stumbled into. It's a time of darkness that they brought on themselves. God kept saying, don't touch the stove, it's hot, it will burn you. Don't touch the stove, it's hot, it will burn you. Don't touch the stove, it's hot, don't touch. There you go. There you go. You want to get burned, help yourself. Okay, so it's something they brought on themselves, provoking the judgment of God. But even in that, God was faithful to them. God kept His promises. God gives them joy in hopelessness. And this is a joy for them at that time, but it's also a joy that will be in supreme fullness later. This entire chapter of chapter 35, it is talking about what they have then, but it's also talking about this joy that they have will be even more full later on. Isaiah declares, and the ransomed of the Lord shall return. Let's look at that word return that Isaiah uses here. Return here means to repent. It means to come back to God. It's not merely being away and then coming back to something, as we will return home after we are finished here this morning. No, it is a heart condition. It is a turning of that. The Lord will ransom His people, but they cannot stay in their ways. They must repent, because this repentance brings joy. If we are struggling with sin in our lives, we will never have joy just confessing that sin, but continuing in that sin. Our joy will come when we repent of that sin, when we return back to God. And the reason being is because our joy is in the King. Our joy is in Jesus Christ. It is in God. That is where our joy lies. So just confessing sin, just saying you're sorry and stopping sinning is not enough. It is turning back to God from where our joy comes from. Acts 5:31 tells us something remarkable about repentance. Repentance is a choice that we make, yes. But the Bible is clear. Do you realize that repentance is a gift from God? Repentance is something that is given to us. Acts 5:31 says, God exalted him at his right hand as leader and savior to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. 2 Timothy 2:25 says, correcting his opponents with gentleness, God may perhaps grant them repentance, leading to a knowledge of truth. Think about that. Even the fact that we repent is because God has granted us repentance. You see, I think that shows even more the darkness of human nature. We like to take a lot of things for granted, thinking we have done a lot of things ourselves, but what we don't understand, we would still be standing in front of God, anger showing on our face, shaking our fist at him, had he not transformed us, had he not called us by name, had he not regenerated our dead spirit through his Holy Spirit. We are dead in our trespasses and sins, folks. I've been to a lot of funeral homes. I've been to wakes, been to these things. I have never seen anything dead respond. Have you? If you have, I'd like to talk to you after the service because that would be an amazing story. But it doesn't happen. Why? Because dead things don't respond. You see, in order to respond, we have to be made alive in Christ, and that is an act of God. So not only does he make us, he calls us by name, he makes us alive, he grants us repentance to turn to him. That's what God's word says. Once again, in our day and time, we have a tendency to maximize men and minimize God when it comes to salvation. But the word of God tells us otherwise. The word of God tells us there is no way, Romans chapter 3, we would not even seek after God if not for him calling us to himself. Because you see what scripture does, scripture minimizes men and maximizes God in all things. And it's important that we read scripture like this. And the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion or Jerusalem with singing. Isaiah says we'll do it with singing. When God ransoms you and grants you repentance, you cannot hide the joy. You cannot hide the joy. It shows. There is indeed a joy for us that we cannot deny, nor can the pressures of this world dim in us. Think about how much this world needs the joy of the Lord. Look around. Go out and do your Christmas shopping. Look at people around. Drive the roads, okay? People need the joy of the Lord. They do not have it. Let them see it in us, brothers and sisters. Nehemiah 8:10 says, says to the people of Israel, and do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. It's your strength. If you are struggling, it's because the joy that you are relying on is not the joy God gives you, because the joy of the Lord is your strength. It's your strength to stand, to let it shine within you. Isaiah then uses the word everlasting. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads, he says. This is quite the opposite of what we gain, again, from our pursuit of joy that the world offers. Everlasting, another word you could substitute in there, is eternal. Now, this joy is not something that was created by the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Let me say this. Let me explain it. It's not something that was created by the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. This is a joy that has been for all eternity. This is a joy that has always been everlasting or eternal in one sense, guys. In one sense is looking forward. We are looking forward to that joy. But eternal and everlasting also looks back. Everlasting and eternal has always been and always will. So it is not as though this joy of knowing and being with God was a new thing. It is a joy that the triune God has always known. It is a joy that the heavenly host has always known by being in the presence of God. It is a joy that we are invited to partake in through the blood of Jesus Christ. Think about that. We are invited to partake in this joy that God knows. There was a time in eternity past where there was just the triune God. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Totally content and happy and joyous in and of themselves. And so this joy that we are telling of, this eternal joy, it has always been. And we are invited to partake in this joy. This is echoed throughout Scripture. This joy will never be interrupted. It is a joy for the people then that would see its ultimate completion later. Isaiah 65:19 says, I will rejoice in Jerusalem and be glad in my people. No more shall be heard in it the sounds of weeping and the cry of distress. Isaiah again in 25:8 says, he will swallow up death forever. And the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces, and the reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lamb has spoken. Isn't that glorious? Revelation 7:17, for the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And again in Revelation 21:4, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. Amen? Our joy in the Lord cannot and will not be stopped by anything this world can do to us. Now, does this mean that we will not weep or hurt? We just saw this. Does it mean we will not weep or hurt? No, I have wept. I have hurt. We all have. What it means is that the joy we have will remain during our weeping and hurting. Let me say that again. The joy we have will remain in these hard times. When you lose a loved one, your joy remains. When you face difficulties in life, joy remains. Weep and hurt. But joy remains as we know that there is a time yet to come when this joy will be, but our weeping and pain will cease forever. There's coming a time when it will end. Our joy is now, but it is future even more. We are enjoying the everlasting joy now, but we will partake in it in a way that we have never dreamed. And that day is coming. That day is coming. Next, Isaiah says they will be given joy. This joy that Isaiah speaks of, this joy that we are speaking of this morning, it is a matter of the heart. Not just any heart, but a heart that has been transformed by God. As I said earlier, our joy, the Christian joy, brothers and sisters, is a joy that the world cannot understand. They cannot fathom why we respond the way we respond at certain times. And this heart issue is explained by Ezekiel in Ezekiel 36:26. It says, I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh, and will give you a heart of flesh. That is telling of regeneration. That the work of the Holy Spirit in your life. There was a time in our life when we had that heart of stone. When we were spiritually dead. But God in his goodness takes our heart of stone and replaces it with a heart of flesh. Making us alive. Now, as we said earlier again, this is a joy that the world cannot know. But those who know the Lord, oh, this joy that we're talking about here, as we said, it's everlasting. It is a joy that should be on our minds and in our hearts from the moment we wake up in the morning. To the moment we close our eyes in slumber at night, it is a joy that we should drink deeply of in all circumstances of life. Psalm 16:11 says, "You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand, pleasures forever." How long? Forevermore. Never ending. Because it says here, in your presence is fullness of joy. Once again, where is our joy? What is the source of our joy, brothers and sisters? It's God. It is God. He is the source of our joy. It is in his presence that we find joy and pleasures evermore. Jesus said in John 15:11, speaking of obedience to God in this passage, "These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full." You see, that's what I'm talking about. We have the joy now, but it will be in fullness to come. So in other words, when we pass, when we die, we will experience this joy in a way that we have never understood. And you know what, guys? That's not even the fullness of joy yet. Because we were created, body and soul, body and spirit. So once we are resurrected and we are in our glorious bodies, then we will experience the living God in a way that he fully intended. So this joy that we are in, this eternal joy, it is just trending up, brothers and sisters. Nothing this world can do can knock it down. It's not like a stock market that sees rises and falls or sees an overinflated balloon that will eventually have to let out some of the air. No, no, no. This is a joy that keeps growing with every phase that we experience in our being. Now, this concept of what I call long-faced Christianity that we see today, you guys know what I'm talking about. You guys have seen it. We probably all participated in it at some point in our lives. This long-faced Christianity is unbiblical. And what I mean by long-faced Christianity is those Christians that are like, "Wouldn't you like to know Jesus? Look what he's done for me." Right? Sign me up. Right? Sign me up. That's what I want. We see some Christians today living as if they are the most miserable people on earth. I don't get it. I don't get it. I just want to say, like, do you know Jesus? Like, do you really know Jesus? Because if you do, I don't think you know the Jesus I know. The Jesus I know doesn't bring you down. The Jesus I know said, "Take my yoke upon you, it's light." Whatever they are selling, this long-faced Christianity, whatever they're selling, let me tell you, brothers, this is the world's not going to buy it. And I don't blame them. Even those who only possess the joy that this world can give seem more joyful than Christians at times. And that shouldn't be the case. We see unbelievers smiling and happy. And here we are. And praise God. Right? When we look at what we gain from this joy and what we lose as a result of this joy, we should be living, breathing, walking, talking billboards for the joy and glory of God to this lost and dying world. But far too often, we're not. We should display our joy in and of the Lord in such a way that the world is curious and desires what we have. Do you know that is a reason that every time there is conflict in the world, every time something happens, there is a spiritual awakening that happens. Church attendance increased for a 2 to 3 year period after the effects of 9/11. Why? The world was frantic. That temporary joy that they were holding on to, it was shattered and broken. But Christians, we had that joy, the real joy. And so who did they flock to? They flocked to that real joy. But you see, they were not transformed by that joy. So after a while, they turned back to the temporary pleasures that the world has. But you see, our joy makes a difference in this world. It is a joy that manifests itself during troubled times. It is a joy that manifests itself in pain and suffering. It is a joy that manifests itself in stressful times of life. It doesn't have to be a dire situation. It can just be in the day in and day out stressful times of life. It's a joy that manifests itself then. It is a joy that manifests itself in the good, the bad, the sad, and everything that lies in between. It is a joy that God's word says will never fail. It'll never fail you. Isaiah continues on here. He says, they shall obtain gladness and joy. They will obtain gladness and joy. Gladness is the experiencing of pleasure, delight, satisfaction, and gratefulness. That sounds wonderful. And this is brought to us by the Lord. And joy, as we just mentioned, is the aspect, in this aspect, is the emotion evoked by well-being, success, good fortune, or the prospect of possessing what one desires. That brings joy. The prospect of possessing what one desires. So that begs the question, doesn't it? What do you desire? If you desire the things the world can give you, it's not going to give you the joy that you seek. It's going to be temporary. Psalm 37:4 tells us what we need to do. Psalm 37:4, the psalmist says, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Now, not the desires of the old you, but the desires of the new you. Because as I said earlier, this joy that we're all seeking, it's only a joy that God can give. It's only a joy that Christians possess. Why do we possess it? Because God has given us a new heart. So therefore it says he'll give us the desires of our heart. Those are his desires. Because he has given us a new heart. When you, we used to have a pastor, first pastor ever served under Pastor Bill Weirich. And he used to have a saying, he was an old country preacher, wonderful man of God. He said, when you are saved, God changes your want to's. He changes your desires. The things that this world has that you used to enjoy, all of a sudden they don't do it any longer. Or it'll be like photographers used to use this stuff called flash paper. Magicians still use it, little flash paper. That's what it is. A joy this world offers, you'll have it, and then poof, it's gone. You will desire what he desires. And we know this because joy is a fruit of the Spirit listed in Galatians chapter 5. This joy that we're speaking of, it is a joy that only comes from the Holy Spirit of the living God. Obviously, it's something the world cannot possess and the world cannot give you. That is how we obtain it. Now, Isaiah 35:10 not only tells us about what is obtained, but it also tells us of what is lost because of this everlasting joy. Now, this is a good thing that we lose things as a result of this everlasting joy. It says, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. Now, this passage of Scripture is what we call a now and a not yet passage. It is now, but it is also not yet in the prophecy. It is a prophecy that applies to the situation the people were in, but also to what is to come on that day, the day the Lord returns and makes all things new. And we should all be excited and looking forward to that day. Anytime the Bible speaks of that day, on that day, it's all talking about the same day. It is the day of the return of Jesus Christ. It is judgment day. It is the day that everything is complete. Judgment is handed out, and Jesus Christ comes in the flesh and makes all things new. We referenced this earlier as well when we spoke of the everlasting aspect of joy. Right now, we experience sorrow and sighing. We talked about that. We still experience sorrow and sighing and weeping right now, but the sting of them has been reduced, hasn't it? Have you ever been to, a funeral of someone who's lost? Anybody ever been to a funeral of someone who's lost? Were you a funeral, Christian at the time? Okay. It's hard. It's a hard funeral. Have you ever been to a funeral of someone who's redeemed? It's like a worship service. It's like a worship service. Because you know of the hope and the joy that you have. You know that that little shell that your friend or loved one has finally been freed from, and that they are in the presence of God, and in the presence of God is joy. We cannot weep for them. We weep because we have lost our friend right now. We are temporarily separated from our friend and our loved one, but that is diminished. It is diminished. We see this difference in the Bible. We read when the child of David and Bathsheba, it was ill and David was fasting and he was in ashes and doing all these things. When the baby died, what did David do? Got up, cleaned up, right? Rejoiced. And he said these words, "He can no longer come to me, but I can go to him. I will go to him one day," right? The baby died. It was over. He did not have to ask for healing anymore because God had granted healing in the greatest way to the baby. He knew he'd see the baby again, so he cleaned up and he kept on going. But look, when David lost Absalom, when David lost his son Absalom, he wept bitterly. He wept bitterly, mourned for his son. Why? Because he knew he would never see his son again. You see, there's a difference. There's a difference in this. And a day is coming when our sorrows will be gone. There's a day that's coming when he will wipe away every tear from our eyes. We will not weep again. Death will be defeated, ultimate defeat at that time. So through this everlasting joy, we obtain gladness and joy both now and the ultimate fullness in the days to come. And sorrow and sighing, even though they are diminished now, one day they will eternally flee and they will be gone. Sorrow and sighing shall flee away. Now, Isaiah is very careful in the words here he uses in the prophecy. The words obtain and flee that he uses here are military terms. They are military terms that Isaiah used here to give us a picture of what this means. Obtain is like a land that is overtaken by a pursuing army. The army obtains this land. The army is a coming force that cannot be stopped. So when he says we will obtain something, it is a certainty. The people knew what he meant. The word flee that's used here is like the word used describing a defeated foe who flees from the victorious army. So Isaiah depicts ultimate victory and the joy of God coming assuredly and the assured defeated foe fleeing forever. So this joy that we celebrate today is a joy that was told of in days of old. It was a joy that was told of all throughout Scripture. It was also a tangible joy in Jesus Christ's first advent. When they held that baby, it was the tangible joy of God brought to them. And a joy also that will bring all things to completion at Christ's second advent. It will be joyful, more joyful than we can understand. Joyful that Jesus came, fulfilling the promises of God, ransoming us, redeeming us to the Father. Brothers and sisters, in wrapping up this morning, I want us to understand why we should have joy And I just want to share a few things with us that we know, but I think sometimes when you put them all together, it gives us a sense of understanding and just evokes worship within us. So let me just share this. During this season, we celebrate Emmanuel. Emmanuel, which means God with us. God is not separate. God is not away from us somewhere. God is with us. We celebrate the Alpha and the Omega. We celebrate the Creator, the bread of life who feeds our souls. We celebrate the great high priest who makes intercession for us before God the Father. We celebrate the Holy One, the sinless one, the perfect Lamb of God. We celebrate the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, over which no one will ever reign higher in past, in present, or in future. We celebrate the light of the world that has come into our darkness. We celebrate the Redeemer. We celebrate our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. That is where our joy comes from, brothers and sisters. It is a joy that should well up within us every second of our lives. Even in our difficult times, we have joy because of this man, this God-man, Jesus Christ, who sits at the right hand of God the Father in the flesh, alive forevermore. And one day will call us to himself and call us home. And brothers and sisters, that's not a bad thing. That is a wonderful, wonderful thing. So Christian, let our joy show forth. A joy that is pure. A joy that is powerful. A joy that is sustaining, that won't drift away from us. But also a joy that will be complete and in fullness in that day when he returns. Let us remember that there was a first advent a couple thousand years ago, but there is a second advent, and we are always in that second advent season, looking, waiting for the return of our joy. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you in ways that we just cannot express, God, for the fullness of joy that is to come, the eternal, everlasting joy that we enjoy right now, Lord. But Father, we don't enjoy it in fullness just yet. Father, we thank you for the first advent of Christ, the first coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. But Father, we yearn. We are excited with anticipation, Lord, for the day he returns, finalizes everything, and brings in the new heaven and earth, life everlasting in your presence, God. We look forward to that. Father God, we thank you for the hope we have in Christ. We thank you for the love you have shown us in Christ. And we thank you for the ever-escalating joy of everlasting joy. And this we ask in Jesus' name, amen. In just a moment, we will have a time of invitation. If you have forgotten about that joy, be reminded today, brother and sister. Let it shine in your life again. Even if you're going through a hard time, there is joy. It's always there. All you have to do, guys, is let it out. Let it out again. Or perhaps you've been looking for joy in things this world gives you. Brothers and sisters, repent of that. Let go of those sandcastles that just crumble in your hand when you hold them. Get washed out by the tide of life as it comes in and out. Let them go and grab on to what is real and everlasting. Or maybe all you ever have experienced here this morning is the joys of this world because you're lost. Because you have never trusted Christ as your Savior. I would invite you this morning, make that decision and you will receive joy that will never end. Or perhaps this morning you've given your heart to Christ, but you've never followed him and been obedient in believer's baptism. I would invite you to make that decision today. to do that. Or for church membership, now would also be the appropriate time. Whatever God is dealing with in your life, will you make that decision today? Will you do that business with God? We will have myself and some deacons and a couple ladies up here. We'd be glad to speak with you and pray with you about whatever your decision is.
Would you stand and sing with us?
We will have a time of dismissal for anyone who is any of our guests today. You are welcome to be dismissed at this time. And for the members, I would encourage you just to hang around as we will have a short call business meeting.
All right, let's sing this last song in response to the joy that David shared with us. This morning, if you remember, please stick around. God bless you.